Well, good morning, and can I welcome everyone to this, the seventh meeting of the Public Audit Committee in 2024. The first item on the committee's agenda is for members of the committee to agree or not to take agenda items 4, 5, 6, 7 and 8 in private this morning. Are we all agreed?
Agreed.
We are agreed. Thank you very much. We've got two sessions of evidence this morning, and the first one of those is consideration of the Auditor General for Scotland's Section 22 report on the 2022-23 audit of NHS Forth Valley. Can I welcome our witnesses who are joining us in the committee room this morning? Amanda Croft, who's the interim chief executive of NHS Forth Valley, and alongside Amanda Croft is Janie McCusker, who's the chair of the board on your last day as chair of the board, so you're very welcome. Thanks for joining us. Andrew Murray is the medical director on the board. Kevin Reith is the director of human resources, and Professor Francis Dodd is the executive nurse director at NHS Forth Valley. So as a committee, we've got quite a number of questions to put to you. But before we get to those, Amanda, could we ask you to make a short opening statement?
Certainly, and thank you, Convener, and thank you to the committee for affording us this time today to speak to you about NHS Forth Valley. In November 2022, NHS Forth Valley was escalated to Stage 4 of the NHS Scotland Performance Escalation Framework, now the Support and Intervention Framework, for concerns relating to governance, leadership and culture. Concerns were also raised in relation to the completion of integration of health and social care, in addition to a range of performance-related issues, notably in GP out-of-hours services, unscheduled care, mental health, specifically child and adolescent mental health services and psychological therapies. Further concerns were raised by Healthcare Improvement Scotland over patient safety at Forth Valley Royal and by NES, around clinical supervision of doctors in training. In October 2023, NHS Forth Valley received a report labelled the External Review of Corporate Governance, detailing 51 recommendations. Prior to the publication of this report, work had already begun on a number of the recommendations. The recommendations from the report were mapped against outcomes of the board's self-assessment survey, which was undertaken in September 2023 against the Blueprint for Good Governance, to ensure that any outstanding actions were captured within the Assurance and Improvement Plan. NHS Forth Valley formally review the progress against the actions in this plan at executive level weekly, at board level monthly, and we have a specific escalation performance and resource committee to do this, and the Scottish Government review progress monthly at the Assurance Board meetings. Significant progress has and continues to be made in several areas regarding culture, leadership, governance, integration, Health Improvement Scotland actions and performance, and these are laid out in the paper that we shared with you prior to today. Many of our actions in the plan are completed, and work across all the priority areas is embedded in existing and future plans, normal business arrangements and our governance process to support continuous learning and improvement. And I won't say any more. Thank you.
Thank you. Amanda Croft, that's a useful introduction for us. The first question we've got is going to be put to you by Willie Coffey. Willie.
Thanks very much, Convener, and good morning to everyone. One of the issues that was raised in the Auditor General's report was the very high proportion of population of the prison population that's in Forth Valley. And you didn't mention that, Amanda, but I'd like to give you the opportunity to share with the committee your views on the impact of having to deal with that disproportionately high population within the Health Board and what kind of impacts it has both on the finances of the Health Board and performance delivery. So just to give you an opportunity to set that record straight for us, please.
Thank you very much. I'll probably say a few words, and I'll maybe ask Francis to come in around the specifics around the healthcare service within the prison population. So the prison healthcare, we have just actually asked the Health and Social Care Partnership to take on the responsibility of the operational management, which is in line with the integration scheme. And over the next year, we'll look at moving that into the integration joint board. That doesn't mean to say the Health Board don't have a big input into that. So in terms of the prison population financially, we are funded for the prison population that we have at the minute. One of our challenges is that we are aware and are starting to receive more prisoners over the next few months, that we are in conversations with Scottish Government and the justice teams, as well as the Health and Social Care Directorate, about how we continue to fund that. But at the minute, funding and the financial issues in the prison, we're managing quite well as far as the health service is concerned. And I'll maybe ask Francis to talk more a bit more about the prison population and the healthcare service. Francis, thank you.
Yeah, thanks very much. We have a mixed population across the three prisons that we provide within NHS Forth Valley. We have young people, we have women, and we have men in our prison population. And we cover a whole range of health services within that. We cover primary care services within the prison, as well as mental health services. We provide speech and language therapy. We provide dietetic support. So a whole range of health services are provided locally to prisoners within the prison environment. We are working really hard to recruit and retain our staff within the prison environment, and we have gone to some innovative ways in terms of how we provide the workforce within that environment. We have open days supported by the Governor from SPS within the prisons. We have Try Before You Buy, where we encourage people to join our staff bank to try prison shifts to make sure we've got the right environment, we've got the right staff with the right skills and abilities to support the prison healthcare within the prison environment. We also provide regular support for patients in terms of escalation to any hospital services, and we work with our SPS colleagues in order to be able to do that. So a full range of services. Some of the challenges are, though, in terms of the ageing population of our prison population, in terms of the responsibilities that we find in terms of that long-term conditions management for the ageing population within prisons. But we have access to the full range of healthcare provision within that. The numbers of prisoners within the population and the mix of prisoners within the population is something that we continually pay attention to and try to make sure that we've got the right health workforce in order to support the needs of that healthcare population within the prisons. And I suppose just in terms of the work that we're doing, we're continuing to refine that. There's a huge amount of improvement work that we're doing within the prisons and a real focus on patient safety and the quality of care that we provide to our prison healthcare population as well. So I think that's probably all I've got to say, but I'm happy to take any more questions.
Yeah, thanks very much for that. Amanda, you were saying you're funded for that prison population, but you've got nearly a quarter of Scotland's entire prison population in your health board area. Does that mean that you need additional different skills, more demanding skills, that perhaps other health boards might not need in order to deliver that care for that ageing population that you describe, Francis?
I think it's a mix of prisoners that we've got across Forth Valley. So we have young people, we have a female population, we have a male population, we have that long-term conditions and that ageing population. So it is an evolving picture, and we have good representation with Scottish Government colleagues in terms of how we connect into the networks across Scotland, but also how we identify what the issues are within our prison healthcare environment. So the connections are good. We're well wired into the networks across Scotland, but also a really solid connection with Scottish Government colleagues. And we've got a very good relationship with our SPS colleagues in terms of how we work collectively together to provide the best support that we can for that prison population. There's always an opportunity to have conversations in terms of making sure that we've got the right resources to support individuals, because the size is an increasing size. And we work, Amanda suggested that we've moved that over into the Health and Social Care Partnership. But from a clinical perspective and a managerial perspective, as well as the professional development of the staff that are in those areas, we really work hand in glove to make sure that we provide the best healthcare that we can for the prison population. Okay. It's not without its challenges.
Can I maybe just add to that? Because of the different types of prisoners that we have in each prison, that means our healthcare delivery is slightly different and the skill mix is slightly different in each prison. And so as we get the increased prisoners that we're getting at the minute, we have to review whether that healthcare service delivery is applicable to that prisoner type. So we're constantly doing that, and each prison, as I say, so young men, women will have different needs to long-term condition prisoners.
But that additional burden that you have in terms of the numbers, mm-hmm. does it or does it not have a direct impact in your financial performance, would you say?
Not that we're noticing right. at the minute. As we get increased prisoners, it definitely will, and we've done some work around that and what that means, and we're in conversations with Scottish Government about that.
OK. Thank you very much for that. I hope to come back in later on as other colleagues develop their questions.
Thank you.
Thanks, Willie. Can I take us to a couple of broader areas? And the first one is around governance. I mean, we look at Exhibit 1 in the Auditor General's Section 22 report, where he notes that concerns about governance arrangements in the Health Board have been flagged since, I think, May 2022, when there was a Scottish Government National Planning and Performance Oversight Group report. But the terms of the independent corporate governance review weren't agreed for another 8 months. And that's January 2023. And then the outcomes of that weren't considered by the board until November 2023. That seems an inordinate delay in addressing something which is pretty fundamental to the functioning of the board. I don't know whether maybe Janie McCusker wants mm-hmm. to come in on that and explain why that timeline looks like it does.
So if I may, Convener, take us back to actually early 2020 when the board was actually in emergency footing, as you're aware. And of course, we were advised by Scottish Government to have more of an agile footing on our governance arrangements, which we did as a board. We had taken to the board on the 31st of March 2020 in terms of how we were going to operate during that timeline. We put in place revised governance arrangements where the board met on a monthly basis, more or less stood down the committees, but also had the committee chairs convene to discuss matters as it related to that timeline. We then reviewed that arrangement in June, and we actually reinstated the governance assurance committees, and all committees by the end of 2020 had met in full session, and we'd resumed by April 21. In terms of, if I'm understanding your question correctly, the governance review that was conducted in that timeline, so it was commissioned and it was anticipated that that would be concluded within about 3 to 4 months. That didn't occur. I don't know the reasons why that didn't occur. We weren't carrying out that. I think there were delays, there were additional interviews that were being conducted. And once that corporate governance review was undertaken, then it came to the board as soon as we had received it. So I don't know if I've quite understood your question or...
Well, my question is, why did it take so long? Why did it take so long for concerns about governance being flagged up in May 2022? Why did it then take until the January of the following year before a review into governance arrangements was established? And why then did it take another 8 months before the conclusions were considered by the board?
So in terms of any governance arrangements that were flagged up, we as a board were considering all of these issues. Our committees were addressing everything that was put in front of us. And in terms of the review, we were waiting for Professor Brown to finalise that. We got the final report in October of 2023. I'm just confirming that date. And as soon as we got that, that came immediately to the board.
Well, yeah, I mean, there do still seem to me to be quite big delays between those different staging posts. Let me turn to another area which has been identified in a number of external examinations of the board, and that is about the culture of the relations with the staff. And in particular, the recurring theme is that the views and the voices of staff were not being listened to. I mean, do you accept that recommendation?
I'll come in first,
sure.
And I'll maybe ask Kevin and Francis to talk about the work that we've done. So I think at the time we do accept that. I think it's important to accept that. If staff are saying that, that's how they're feeling, and we've taken it very seriously. So, Kevin, I'll ask you to come in, and then, Francis, you, if you might come in on the latest HIS report and inspection where they gave us some very good feedback about what staff were saying. Kevin, please.
Thank you. And, Chair, you'll see from our submission that we've done significant work on culture. We have been progressing a huge culture and change and compassionate leadership programme, recognising that we wanted to make improvements in this area. We've done a huge amount of work engaging with staff across the organisation over the last over 12 months now. We've done a great amount of diagnostic work and a kind of a discovery phase, which was about listening to our staff, listening to what their views were and listening to the concerns they had. We took those and we've taken those into key themes for the organisation. And in the tail end of last year, we were looking at bringing that together to develop a kind of feedback to our staff to look at how we then take that work forward with them. It's very much about co-creation for us. Having heard our staff's views, we want to hear about how we can work with them to develop and deliver changes in the organisation and the culture we have. So between now and April, we are working with our staff, taking that back out to them to hear what they want us to do and what we want to change. Clearly, we've also referenced the whistleblowing and the speak-up work that we do. I've been in a number of boards, and whistleblowing has been something that I see given great attention in the organisation. We're very much about learning, though. I mean, it's something about continuing to learn how that works. The standards have been new for all boards. We have been looking at how our staff recognise how they can raise concerns through the appropriate channels. We've done some work, and you'll see in our submission that we've done some work to improve that. Francis might want to comment on how we've developed that speak up and whistleblowing.
Yeah, but before Professor Dodd comes in, I mean, so you referenced the note that you sent us in advance of your appearance here today. I mean, there was quite a lot of managerial jargon in it, and it was quite long. And when it came to staff relations, it mainly did just talk about whistleblowing. Now, I mean, I think we all accept that whistleblowing is part of a suite of ways in which the staff's voices can be heard. But I would have thought whistleblowing public interest disclosures were in extremis. I think the point that, as I read it, has been made in some of these external reviews, the HIS review being one of them, is that there's not kind of very good normalised routine communications with the staff, including, I presume, through the staff trade unions. So I don't know whether Mr. Reith, as the HR director, want to comment on that.
I'm happy to comment on that. I mean, since I've come on board, there was already arrangements where we've got a regular APF, monthly APF, Area Partnership Forum meeting with our staff side reps. We're also, I meet with them every fortnight, our senior staff side colleagues. I meet with them and the employee director. We have an open communication. We look at early intervention, looking at trying to get into issues before they become bigger. And it's been a really helpful sharing platform. I continue to do that with them. So every fortnight I'll be meeting with them, and there's an open door from the employee director and staff side colleagues to do that with me and with other members of the executive. The other thing we've been doing is we've embraced that in the way we do our work now. So we have significant challenges to face, like all boards, in terms of managing financial pressures that are coming in the next year. We have been working every fortnight with our staff side colleagues on board with the executive to look at how we bring their views into frame, how they give us feedback around how we communicate with staff, how we do that work with them in collaboration. So that's been very much part of how we set our stall out to do things differently.
And just, I'm an old-fashioned trade union person, so when you talk about we engage with our staff colleagues, you mean you sit down with the NHS trade unions? Or you have another...
Yeah.
Because partnership working, again, is meant to be a hallmark of good working in the NHS in Scotland. And one of the things that we're trying to understand is the extent to which that has or has not been working.
So if I may come in there. So at our last Area Partnership Forum, the feedback we had from our staff side colleagues, our trade union colleagues, is that they felt visibility of the executive team was greater. They felt that we were working better. They appreciated early engagement with them, which we've been doing on a number of things, particularly the money. And that is actually recorded in our Partnership Forum minutes. So it wasn't an informal statement. And we are getting that feedback quite frequently now. In fact, one of the bits of feedback we had was we're finding ourselves too busy because we're engaging them very early. So I think that feedback is really important to us. What we're asking for, what I'm asking for from them, is that this is a two-way thing. So we will engage with you, but we need you to tell us what staff are saying. You're closer to staff. So that's the type of culture we're trying to create with our trade union colleagues. They're the people very close to our staff, far closer than we are. And I think that over the past few months, we're certainly noticing that, and they're telling us that that is definitely improved. And I think the HIS inspection that happened a couple of weeks ago when Francis comes in, I think you'll get more evidence of that as well.
Okay, well, if you want to come in briefly on that particular thing about staff relations under the HIS report, because we've got other questions about the HIS report.
Yes, no problem at all. When the HIS team came in between the 22nd and the 24th of January for a follow-up visit on the inspections that they'd previously undertaken in 22, they noticed with us the process for escalating concerns from a staff perspective was significantly improved. Staff commented that there was a much more open culture. They felt heard, they felt listened to, actions were taken and risks were mitigated. That was feedback from the staff on the ground to the HIS inspectors. They felt that the safety huddles that we undertake through our normal business processes were much more open. They felt that they were a psychologically safe environment for people to say what they felt were their concerns, and that they felt that staff were listened to. They felt that they were escalating the right issues through that route, and that staff were then responded to through that way. So in terms of that, that was an affirmation of some of the work that we've been doing, but also we've been doing some work across the nursing, midwifery and AHP community to look at what does psychological safety mean, you know, in terms of if you're a staff nurse or a clinical support worker or a physiotherapist, but trying to understand what are the conditions that we need to create for people to be comfortable to raise concerns. And that's maybe not always been the case, that people have been comfortable to raise concerns, but trying to work from a leadership point of view to make sure that the conditions are absolutely different and that people feel comfortable to say when things are not okay. And it's our response to that and how we then take things forward with staff that reinforces through our behaviours as leaders across the organisation and role modelling those behaviours to make sure that people understand it's safe to say that things are not OK in Forth Valley. And that absolutely is what came through in the HIS inspection.
Right, good. Thanks for that answer. I'm going to bring Graeme Simpson in, who wants to come in on some of this area.
Thanks, Convener. Just on this line of questioning, Mr Reith, question to you. What would you say you were getting wrong before?
In respect of our engagement with staff? And
yeah, on this whole culture question.
Well, I think what we recognise is that the ability of our staff to kind of raise those concerns, perhaps we needed to be giving them better opportunity to understand how they do that. And actually, I suppose back to what Francis has said, to some extent, what I've seen, it's difficult for me, I'm hesitating slightly, because what I've seen is that quite an open approach since I've joined. I joined sort of in the summer, late summer last year.
Okay.
And it's been very much about the way in which we set our stall out and the way we've approached this, and Amanda's leadership style has been about doing that. Very kind of engaging approach, open approach. I think the thing I was struck by was how open our staff psychologists were in sharing their concerns with me when I joined. So we had that opportunity to say, what can we do to sort this? How can we fix this? And how can we make sure those staff voices are heard? We've had to put some, you know, those partnership arrangements could have certainly been missing in some of our areas. We've re-established work in the acute side, where that was perhaps not working as regularly and as consistently as we wanted it to. So I've seen a really open approach to the way we deal with this. Our staff side colleagues appreciate the opportunity to have that early intervention conversation, and it's not just with me, it's with all our executive colleagues, you know, the opportunity to say, what can we do before this becomes more problematic or more conflictual? So that's something that's been an element of our culture.
So I don't recognise
some of what was before, you know, I wasn't there.
Yeah. When you came in, you could obviously, from what you've just said, you could see there were problems that needed to be fixed.
Thank you.
You were here. I'll
come in for a couple of points then. Good morning. I'm Andrew Murray, Medical Director. I'm probably the longest serving board member, so I can give a bit more of that historical context. What I would like to start out by saying absolutely is night and day in terms of those relationships with staff and where we are now. It's taken escalation and the work through escalation and some of what's within the various reports that we've got for us to be able to get the momentum and the and really the engagement with our staff. And that, looking back, I think the question was asked, you know, from a cultural perspective, what were we getting wrong and what were we not acting on? Probably a missing piece of the jigsaw between what Janie described as the governance light peri-pandemic time and the report that was commissioned, which I agree was, it took a long time for that to be brought into the organisation. I think there was some frustration around that, but I think ultimately it was an excellent piece of work that really allowed us to make meaningful impact with a lot of the recommendations. But a missing piece of the jigsaw was in 2021, there was an external review of NHS Fourth Valley again, which started out, it's known locally as the ED review. There was four NHS executives, previous executives, who were an external group who came in to look at NHS Fourth Valley. And they widened out the terms of reference to look at all aspects of governance as well. And their recommendations, there was a reasonable amount of media coverage at the time. Scottish Government colleagues were aware of that as well. So that had given us, so to be fair to us on the board, that had given us a long list of potential or recommendations which then turned into action plans. So we worked through those diligently. There was a subcommittee set up, which Janie chaired. Really, we were attempting to correct many of the findings or many of the issues that had been raised. Some of those, though, there is a read across, and Professor Brown mentions it within his report. He acknowledges the ED report. So I think when you're looking back, there is a longer history. It wasn't just with it. So escalation doesn't come out the blue. Escalation, you know, obviously comes out as a culmination of processes. And we've talked and we heard previously about the HIS information. We've heard about the deanery information. But actually, those in themselves, those were not why we were escalated. We were escalated for leadership, culture and governance. And as I said, there is a context there. So we had been working hard as a board, working through those action plans, but we hadn't managed to have the impact of the delivery. And it took the really report of Professor Brown and the escalation process for us to be able to start to transform. And I'll go back to what I started off by saying, it's night and day now compared to how it was.
I've got other questions other areas.
Okay. I'm going to turn then to Colin Beattie. Colin.
Thank you, Convener. I was going to ask a question about improving training for board members. Having read the Auditor General's report and the Corporate Governance Review, the level of incompetence is absolutely breathtaking as far as the board's concerned. No challenge, very little scrutiny. There seems to be no understanding of proper governance. To me, an induction for board members is an induction rather than training. Board members should be chosen for the skills that they have, for the expertise that they can bring to the board, and not because they come in needing training. Is there a problem with our recruitment process for non-execs? This is not the first time that this committee has looked at problems that have arisen within the public sector, and at least some issues were found with the way the non-execs approached the situation. Now, I'm not blaming the board solely for this. There's other issues in this as well, but I'm focusing on the board. Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Is there a problem with our recruitment process?
Janie.
Thank you, Mr. Beattie. So, as you're aware, the Scottish Government lead on the recruitment process for non-exec directors for health boards. There are some specific set skills that the board is required to have, such as finance. We also now have clinical governance non-executive director on the board, which came in after my arrival. It was a key area. I wanted the board to have that skill set for a non-executive director. Prior to that, we didn't have that skill set on the board. So the Scottish Government lead on that non-exec director, and it's based on the skills we might be looking for at a particular time when we have the opportunities for recruitment. I think certainly in terms of Forth Valley, I think our non-exec representation could be expanded. But what we have now in terms of induction, when a non-exec director arrives, we actually have an induction package that we give to them. And certainly we have had, in 2021, we've had an active governance training programme that was run by NES. There have been previous governance programmes run with the board prior to my arrival. We do also have board seminars that go into specific areas of the business in detail. So it builds up that knowledge of a board and the non-execs. And their primary role, as you, of course, are aware, is to provide that scrutiny to the executive directors for the delivery. So in terms of your question, I'm not sure I'm fully conversant to be able to say there is a problem. I've been involved in two recruitment processes that are led by the Scottish Government. I provided the criteria that at that time would have welcomed onto the board, which was a criteria that we're actually statutory required to have, and was able to recruit that skill set onto the board through that process.
I hear what you're saying, that there's been training provided to the board over a period of years. There's induction, all the rest of it. Didn't work so well. I mean, what is the point of training people, giving them all this gains, when it would appear on every side it didn't work? They didn't take any notice of it. Where's the scrutiny? Where's the challenge?
Well, since I've been on, we have some very strong non-exec directors who have provided scrutiny and challenged on the board. In terms of the HIS, we challenged on that. We got assurances at that time, and again, the HIS came back and deliberated otherwise, that we hadn't fully implemented the recommendations. But certainly, I provide a lot of scrutiny at the board, and our other non-execs do provide scrutiny at the board.
Well, looking at the governance review and the overall picture that I'm seeing here at my desk, it doesn't look that good.
I'm happy to come in. So I joined the board in September of 23. I don't recognise that lack of scrutiny. Now, I'm presuming that's because a lot of work has been done since being in escalation, but I don't recognise that lack of scrutiny at the board or in the committees.
I mean, I'm pleased if it's improved, but being an audit committee, of course, we look backwards.
Yes.
So we're looking at what was, not so much what is.
Yes.
And trying to get to the bottom, drill down as to why this happened and how it can be prevented in the future. That's really our role. And it would appear that there have been significant gaps in governance here. And we really want to get to the bottom of it and find out how we can ensure that doesn't happen again.
Because
there is a pattern.
Yeah,
it has happened elsewhere. Not necessarily to the same extent as this, but it has happened elsewhere. Therefore, is there an endemic problem? Is there a problem in the recruitment processes? We look at everything.
Mm-hmm. Possibly if I can speak about Forth Valley. In mid-November, we did bring in a board secretary, which Forth Valley hadn't had in its true form previously. And the role of a board secretary is exactly that, to make sure non-executives are inducted properly, have the right skills, support them with any development. And I suspect that bringing that role into Forth Valley has definitely supported our development around that. And I obviously can't speak for other boards, but certainly I think in Forth Valley, I do think that's definitely improved, because I don't recognise that. That non-scrutiny since I've been in post, which is September.
Which is a relatively short time. But
it is.
Looking at the board, I would like some reassurance going forward that proper security and challenge, scrutiny and challenge is in place. Because hopefully we've learned by all the deficiencies that have been thrown up both in the audit and in the corporate governance review. What sort of reassurance can we have that these have been rectified?
Well, certainly we're looking at strengthening and further conducting the active governance programme training for the board. We have undertaken the self-assessment at the board. We've had two facilitated by an external facilitator sessions of the board to identify areas where we have been actually strong and also areas that we have been weak. And we have put in place through the Assurance Improvement Plan how we will strengthen that governance going forward. So that is absolutely there. The 51 recommendations from Professor Brown's report is incorporated into that plan. There's been a lot of mapping done around that piece of work. We have a separate escalation assurance board that looks at all of that work. So certainly it's about strengthening where we're identifying the skill sets that we have, where we need to strengthen that skill set, and where we need to strengthen any further induction, either through existing mechanisms or anything else that we can bring on board. So I can absolutely give you that assurance that that has all been taken into consideration and how we strengthen all of that going forward.
I'll go back to a point I made before. Training is fine and necessary for a board in terms of new requirements, how the whole process develops to keep them up to speed and keep them on the same in the same road. But I expect when a board member gets appointed, that person does have the skills and experience and the ability to be a board member without a huge amount of training. Otherwise, what's the point?
Well, majority of non-exec directors won't come from a health background. I certainly do not come from a health background. I think perhaps where it could be strengthened would be an induction programme, perhaps by the Scottish Government, into some key aspects of the business, and that might be helpful. We do have access to online systems and online availability, as you say, for training. But it can take, a bit of time to really get into the business of the organisation. And that's why you have succession planning, so that you're not having everybody obviously leaving and arriving at the same time. You've got that networking with the existing board members that will bring along new board members as well coming in so that they can understand. So that's a bit like a mentoring system from within the board as well. And it's an informal system. It's not a formal, but that occurs as well.
Yeah. My understanding is, from other evidence we've taken in other sessions, that each NHS board has unique characteristics in the way it's developed and so on. So there would be a need for each board to provide a level of familiarisation with the business that the director's coming into. But that's normal with anything. Mm-hmm. It's not unique to the NHS. Non-exec directors get appointed to the boards of many different types of private and public organisations. Let me move on.
Yeah, we're quite against the clock, and I'll bring you back in, but I'm going to bring Graham in at this point.
Thanks again, convener. I've got a few questions. I'm going to start with the current financial position. You very helpfully shared with local MSPs a paper. It was called Finance Report, dated 30th of January. In that paper, it said that the current forecast deficit is estimated at £10.3 million. Mm-hmm. You also say in that paper, it's highly unlikely that break-even can be achieved without additional funding from the Scottish Government and or significant improvement in the acute services division financial performance between now and the end of the year. So, I mean, has there been any improvement since that paper was produced?
Yes, thank you, Mr. Simpson. So our latest position is that we are quite close now to delivering a break-even position. Okay. And that is mainly due to additional national resources coming from Scottish Government. So we don't know the exact figure yet, and obviously that would need to go through our board at the end of March before we made anything public, but that is our current position.
So the government's offered to give you more money, basically?
So all boards have had some additional resources from the Scottish Government.
OK, and that you think that will help you to...
We are quite confident that we'll come very close to a break-even position.
OK. And I presume you're still having to make savings?
Absolutely. And certainly going into next year, it's very challenging for all boards, and we're working on our financial plan for next year, where we're looking at a significant saving, as all boards are, mm-hmm. and we're in a very different position next year. So we're working on that, and that's what we're talking about with the trade unions. We're working very closely with them, because there will need to be changes in terms of how we work and deliver services potentially, but again that financial plan will be finalised at the board meeting at the end of March.
And we've heard previously, and you refer to it in mm-hmm. in this paper, that a large number of the savings are non-recurring.
Yes.
So if that's the case, it's not very sustainable, is it?
No.
No.
I'll just be very honest with you. I think that's how certainly in my experience in the health service, and I've got quite a few years as a director level in the health service and a few years as a chief executive, that is how we tend to manage. It's not the best way to do it, but in the health service. And you know, Forth Valley isn't escalated for money. We've not, in recent years, never asked for brokerage. They've always broke even. We're the lowest rung of the ladder for in terms of the escalation programme, and I think that's because internally the auditors and external auditors are quite reassured and have confidence in our processes, but that doesn't mean to say we haven't got challenges ahead, and non-recurring savings are not the way anybody would want to go, but reality, I'm afraid.
So that essentially means that you're going to be facing this position mm-hmm. every year unless we can sort that out.
Yes.
Yeah. So every single year, you're going to be having to make...
and I'm just glad I'm not a director of finance.
Big savings.
Yes, absolutely. And you know, I'm not being flippant when I say yes. It is, unfortunately, how we have to work. Now, we've got a savings plan in place for next year. You'll know about the agency spend, and I'm sure you'll want to know more about that at some point.
Yeah.
We want to bring that down. That potentially is recurring savings, depending on the workforce. So there's lots of it's a really complex area, as I'm sure you would agree. But yes, it's not a great position to be in year on year. Unfortunately, that is how we've worked for many years.
What's the implication of that for patients? Because they're the people that matter, aren't they? Well, your staff matter, of course, but at the end of the day, you're delivering for the public.
Absolutely, and it continues to be a challenge, and that's why we have robust systems in place around patient safety and governance, because any change in a funding source or challenges, our biggest challenge is workforce and getting the right workforce that isn't agency, but all boards in Scotland are facing similar problems. So I'm not going to sit here and say it may not impact on patient safety, but we have robust systems in place to try and ensure that the patient safety and the quality continues as we would want it to.
What's the proportion of agency staff that you employ?
I'm going to turn to Professor Dodd now, please.
We're significantly trying to reduce the number of agency staff that we've got. We want to, in the last few months, we've removed off-framework agency from a nursing and midwifery perspective. So we don't use any off-framework. We have in the last...
What do you mean by off-framework?
So there's... the agencies can come to us in some ways. There's a framework arrangement within Scotland where we can go to certain agencies that broker into a certain framework payment, and there were other agencies that provided a workforce to us that were in an off framework, so they didn't stick within the rules of the framework. So we've completely removed our off framework staff in use in the last few months, and we did that very, very quickly with really good governance control. I and my deputy sign off on any of those shifts. So that's the level of intensity that we are scrutinising, making sure that the quality and safety of care is not impacted by that, but looking at all of the supplementary staffing solutions that we've got in order to be able to provide the level of care for our patients and support for our staff to do the right job at a time when we are under significant demand, in terms of the patients coming through the system. So that's one thing that we've done. We're now looking to see how we can maximise our recruitment, making sure that we've got all of the options available to us, making sure that we're recruiting locally as well as internationally to try and meet the challenges in terms of some of the vacancies that we've got. And we're looking to reduce the number of healthcare support workers that we use through agency, and we've reduced that by 68% in the last month. So we've got a lot of work, and again, I sign off on all of those in hours, and my executive director colleagues authorise those in the out of hours period. So really good governance and control around that, making sure that we focus on what is the requirement for staff and patients to be looked after well, and the staff wellbeing is a factor in that as well, but aligned with what we'd expect from a professional perspective around the numbers of staff that we require in order to meet the patient needs.
Okay. My question was, what's the percentage of agency staff that you use? Do you have that figure?
I don't know that I have that exact figure. I don't know if you have it, Kevin.
I would have to provide it offline. I mean, we're certainly looking at reducing that. We've recognised we've had a higher figure than, as Francis has said, we would ideally want. That step process is moving.
It'll be interesting to have actual numbers.
It is a tiny proportion in comparison to our substantive staff, but I can get you the number. I don't have the exact number.
That's fine. Another question. In this, it was a long submission that you sent in. There was a lot of jargon in it. One piece of jargon I want you to explain. It says, this is on page 4 of your submission. Through November and into December 2023, Forth Valley has undertaken a fire break or system reset aiming to decompress the Forth Valley Royal Hospital site. Now, I don't know what that means. Can you explain it?
Yeah, and read back like that, I can see exactly why it's a little bit mystifying. So, because of our unscheduled care performance is very challenged, and that really is at the heart of so many of the issues that our regulators and inspectors have picked up on, that the HIS inspection was really looking at the patient's experience in unscheduled care. The deanery visit, which was mentioned earlier in this, again picked up issues that were as a consequence of our challenges there. So our system, and by that we tend to mean the whole system, so the unscheduled care process from people becoming unwell in the community all the way into the hospital and then all the way to discharge. Our system has, over the recent past and the last few years, has really struggled to deliver what it needs to for the patients out of Forth Valley. So there are various ways that we can try and improve, obviously, and data is a big part of that. We work closely with Scottish Government colleagues to understand our data, where they see improvements, and we worked recently with the Centre for Sustainable Delivery, where unscheduled care is now based. From a government perspective, and they've really helped with us understanding the opportunities within our system to improve. The that sounded quite jargony again, sorry, I just realised.
Keep me on track. Sorry.
Yeah, I'll do this. So the fire break itself is another method of doing that. It's another method of saying, how can we transform and reset our system? So what it meant in practical terms was that senior managers, everybody that could unblock decision-making and unscheduled care down tools away from their day job, and they concentrated purely on what we could do to improve unscheduled care. So it took us into that real kind of short-term rapid improvement process. And we were trying to see what we could, using the data, what we could really influence over that time. And so we fundamentally learned a lot. It didn't transform the system, though. And so that was one of our real frustrations, that we undertook that. We invested a lot of time. We used the data, but we really struggled to unlock what we were trying to unlock, which was shorter stays for patients, better performance at the front door, et cetera. So that was frustrating for us, because other systems... Sorry, using that kind of jargon. So NHS Lanarkshire did this, and you know, they could see some gains. NHS Borders did a kind of similar thing, a Kaizen thing, got some gains. Every system finds it really difficult to sustain it, though. So we learned a lot, and it really helped refine the next iteration of our unscheduled care improvement work. And that has got the output from the fire break, CFSD data, our local improvement plans as well. That constitutes our improvement processes and plans for unscheduled care and how we're trying to solve some of the long-standing issues within the system.
I'm not sure I'm any clearer. However...
I can try and refine it if you've got a follow-up question.
Well, I'm happy to leave it there.
Okay, I'm going to bring Jamie Green in at that point then. Jamie.
Thank you, Convener. And thank you. Good morning. Can I start? Mr. Murray, did you say earlier that you were the longest-serving member of the board or just here this morning?
I would need to double-check, but I'm pretty sure that's the case. Yes, Jamie's confirmed for me.
This morning, yes.
And I guess, and please don't take this question personally in one sense, but... In that position, seeing your health board escalate to level 4, which is one off from level 5, which is the most serious, which means effectively means the government has no confidence in the board at all to deliver effective and safe care to patients. Level 4 is almost there. My question is, as a member of the board, both individually and collectively, how could the board have let that happen over a course of a number of years to get to the stage where the government has had to intervene in such a fashion? I mean, surely as a board, you would be ongoing monitoring and auditing of processes and outcomes and practices within the board. I mean, if this was a private business, it'd be difficult to see how you'd be sitting here this morning.
Yeah, and I think there's been, you know, certainly from a personal perspective, a lot of reflection on how I could have worked differently. What could I have contributed that might have helped us move forward more effectively previously, because as I've alluded to, you know, we can go back over a period of years. It's really clearly set out within Professor Brown's report. I think he really has identified a lot of the key issues around how the executive leadership team struggled to build trust and to function. It's documented there in the summaries that he's providing the recommendations. We went through several attempts through, you know, formal development processes to see if we could improve that performance. Then we had that external report that I mentioned earlier in 2021, which again, you know, is referenced by Professor Brown. It again identified leadership culture and governance issues. That, in retrospect, you can say, well, there were some red flags there. There was, you know, there was the frequency of a team having to go through formal organisational development to try and build relationships. That, you know, you look back and think that was something that actually was telling the wider board a story. And I think there was... So, speaking from the executive team perspective, there was a real desire that we tried to be work as professionally as we could through that, through what were clearly challenges for us being able to reach collaborative decisions that were in the best interest of the patients. That was a feature really of those that period of time. But we were trying to be as professional as we could through that, because that's our role really. It's about trying to work through that. But it became increasingly apparent. And as I said, I think when you look back, it's you can join those dots fairly clearly. One of the other points, though, that I was going to mention was, so there is the agencies that have been spoken about who also have a view of NHS Forth Valley provided us with reports and feedback. And there's also a national process called shared intelligence, where all those agencies come together, and the health board only applies to health boards. They're not part of that process, but they review all the data for the health board, and they provide a view of the organisation. And I think in retrospect, so there was nothing really came from that process. So that's HIS. I don't think the regulators are involved in it, but Audit Scotland are involved in it. There's a group of agencies that come together to make that assessment of an organisation. And I was just looking back at some of those reports. There was never anything really identified that was an issue within NHS Fore Valley. But I think for those of us who were in the system, certainly, were experiencing some of those difficulties and challenges.
We are very short in time, and I do want to move on.
Sorry.
I mean, surely the proof would have been in the pudding, and as Mr. Simpson said, surely outcomes to patients are what matters.
Yeah.
And if you could see a pattern of deterioration in outcomes, for example, if you look at your four-hour emergency access compliance, it's down at 50%, which is way below the Scottish average, which already is quite low. And that dropped considerably over a period of time. And surely all those red flags, you know, the CAMS statistics, the GP access out of hours, the psychological assessment referral waiting times, 18-week waiting times, and surely all of these together over a period of time would have been massive red flags to the board that performance was in danger of escalation.
Yeah, I think it was, and I think Janie's concurring there. When we saw, what I would say is the escalation process seems to have worked. So that's I noted from the previous session. You know, the systems of regulation and checks and balances seem to work, and that we've now, I'll go back to what I said earlier. You know, the culture certainly within the senior leadership team is significantly different, and we are now making decisions which are going to benefit patients. But looking back, yeah, absolutely, there was a lot, real difficulties in the... So the acute site is where the four-hour emergency access standard is measured. There was real difficulties with the leadership within that particular site for a long period of time. It was very inconsistent. So we were really struggling, and it goes back to the comments earlier about the culture and the staff. You know, that site really hasn't had the support that it needed to be able to deliver. So that was known to all within the board. I was watching our four-hour emergency access standard deteriorate. I was briefing the board on that. But it was also because of the patient harm that occurs, people waiting over 12 hours in the emergency department, there's a recognised association with mortality. People die as a result of waiting. Yeah. So these are weighty subjects. So I'm also taking professional advice from senior medics within government as well to say, look, I'm seeing this situation happening. I'm seeing the deteriorating picture. And I'm also seeing a team that are not able to take the corrective action to try and improve that. And I think that was probably some softer intelligence that resulted in the escalation process being triggered. Yeah. I think it's absolutely regrettable that it ended up that we had to be escalated for us to be able to make the impact and try and bring some of the benefits for patients that we were describing.
And can I maybe move on to the present day? We can spend a lot of time in retrospect, and I'm sure lessons will be learned, and I'm sure there's a lot of personal regret involved in the executive leadership team. However, can I ask Ms. Croft, in your current situation, where we're at the moment with some of these service improvements? Because, you know, it's still looking quite grim for patients and Fore Valley in terms of waiting times across a number of key metrics. The risk of this being a lengthy answer, which we don't have time for, but what are some of the steps you're taking right now to improve, for example, four-hour A&E turnaround, for example, 18-hour referrals for mental health assessments and so on? And what are the limiting factors? We've obviously talked about workforce, we've talked about finances, but what are the key barriers that you think exist right now to make immediate improvements so that you can de-escalate out of level four?
Thank you. So I'll be really brief and high level. I'm very happy to share detail in writing if that's helpful around.
Yeah. What are the key takeaways? So the members of the public watching this.
So the key takeaways are that our CAMS
performance as of January is the best in Scotland. Yep. Our psychological therapies has improved and is in the pack, as we call in the pack, another jargon, sorry.
Well, it's 64% against a target of 80. So
I've probably got more up-to-date information. So psychological therapies is definitely workforce related, and that will definitely fluctuate as the workforce fluctuates. It's a very specialised area, but in terms of where the team were and where they are now, I won't talk about the four-hour bit. Andrew may wish to come in. And our out-of-hours services, GP services, has improved greatly. The fill rate is improved up into the 90s, I think Andrew's correct. And Sir Lewis Ritchie, who supported that work, there's a session next week with him to, I think, close that work off, because the performance is very good. In terms of our planned care, you'll note that Forth Valley is probably one of the best performing boards in many of the areas. I won't go into detail, very happy to supply you with that information. So I'll tell you what the key issues are and what we need to do. Yeah. We need good, strong leadership. So good general management leadership, good clinical leadership at nurse director level, at medical director level, and we need that across the system. And we also need the system to work as a whole system. So not just working with the acute sector around the four-hour target, working with our primary care colleagues and our integration joint boards and our health and social care partnerships. We will not do this alone as a health board. And that is the work that we are doing and continuing to do. And again, since I've been in post, I've seen a huge improvement in that. But happy to supply any more detailed data around the performance of those access waiting times that you require.
Thank you. Yeah, any updates you could, in addition to today's meeting. It's interesting, though, that a lot has been mentioned around workforce, and we've talked in great detail about executive leadership and the importance of that. But the other key finding from the external review of corporate governance, which it says was the, I quote, root cause of many of the significant challenges you face as a health board, was actually a failure to agree an appropriate business model for the delivery of integrated health and social care, and that's an area I haven't spent a lot of time on this morning. But has that improved?
Absolutely. So the integration review scheme, when integration first came into place, one of the key things that boards were asked to do was transfer services. So I've mentioned the prison today, so we've just transferred that over. That will go over into the integration, but it's a very complex system, and I won't keep going on about jargon. But one of the first things that Forth Valley did was transfer those services. So mental health, primary care, GP out of hours, they were still sitting with the health board. So they've now moved over into the health and social care partnerships. The two chief officers that work in that lead the integration joint boards are very much part of our executive team. They're involved in every decision. We don't make decisions that will impact on primary care or health and social care partnerships, and vice versa. They're included in our financial savings plans conversations going forward. We're working really closely with our local authorities as well. So Forth Valley as a region has decided to have one anchor board institute, which is about community wealth growing, instead of four. So in Forth Valley we could have four. We've got three councils, one health board. We've agreed to have one. So I think that is a real signal that we're talking to each other, we're working well together, we're talking about the resources that we have collectively and how we can work with them differently. So I can go on and on, and I'm conscious of time.
That's fine. And I guess my parting question is, Ms. McCusker, it's your last day in the job as chair. What would your advice be to the incoming chair?
To make sure that they're made aware of all the issues that perhaps led to where we are today, and to understand and be briefed on in more detail of what has gone and what is to continue. So I think that's important for an incoming chair, to be made aware of any issues historical that needed to be addressed, and also the focus on continuing the trajectory of the progress that the board has made.
Thank you, Convener.
Thank you very much. I think Willie Coffey wants to come back in. Willie.
Thanks, Convener. Amanda, I was listening again to your comment that you made earlier on about the progress on the 51 recommendations. And with the benefit of some time here while colleagues were asking questions, I've got a look at your executive report, your escalation update report that was given to the board only a month ago. And it says in there that 5 of the recommendations have been completed. You said that many have been completed. I wonder if you would mind clarifying for the committee.
Certainly.
It says 14 are moved into an assurance and improvement plan, but there's 32 of the recommendations still outstanding. So
yes.
Could you clarify what the actual position is?
Certainly. So again, we'll definitely have more up-to-date information and very happy to supply that. We're just about to take another Assurance Board paper to the Scottish Government Assurance Board meeting. Get confused with all the meetings. And the current position is that we've now completed 89% of those actions, which means we've still got 5 high-level actions open. But one of the things we've learned and had feedback from the escalation committee is that we were concentrating very much on what we call enabling actions. I'm sorry, I'm using jargon again. So these are actions that allow us to close off that sort of broader action. And so we've carried out a huge amount of work over the last 3 weeks, just really looking at that. And we've closed a lot of actions off, which doesn't mean we're stopping the work, but the work has started and the work will continue in what we call our normal business. It's fair to say that many of those actions from the external review and other reviews, I think you commented in the last Public Audit Committee about the amount of reviews that Fort Valley has had. I forgot what I was going to say now. It's fair to say that... sorry, I've lost my train of thought there. So we've got 5 actions still open, and that's around some of the culture work, some of the governance work, and the main bit of work around the governance work is embedding what they call an assurance framework. And again, it is jargon, but all boards have an assurance framework, which means all their processes align to one framework, and it tells you how one committee relates to another committee that relates to the board. And with all the leadership actions are closed, but the culture and the governance actions, I think we've still got 5 high-level actions open.
I mean, that's a huge jump, really, in a month, where your board paper actually says you've only completed 5.
Yes.
That's a huge jump in 1 month.
And I think the latest paper explains that.
Okay. Who is reviewing that performance to be assured that this is the genuine picture at the current... Who's doing that verification?
So the board have a escalation performance and resource committee every month. And we've just recently had one of those, was it 1 or 2 weeks ago? Mm-hmm. And the Scottish Government have what we call an assurance board, and that's every month as well. The executives look at everything every week, and we're the ones supplying the information and going through and scrutinising, well, have we closed that off or haven't we? However, the board, on a monthly basis, have an escalation performance and resources committee, but we also discuss some of these actions in the relevance committees of the board. So, for example, the staff governance committee, the culture work is discussed in the clinical governance committee, the patient safety, the HIS work and things. So there's a number of committees that accumulate in an escalation committee that accumulates in the assurance board at the Scottish Government.
But you're confident that 89% of these recommendations are completed? Okay, thanks. We'll leave it at that. Thank you.
Okay. Can I just really, before we finish up, just take us back to the report that was produced 22 months ago now by the Healthcare Improvement Scotland unannounced inspection. I mean, for example, they reported that they found a lack of documented risk assessment, for example. They reported that the addition of a 5th bed within a 4-bedded bay created what they felt to be breaches of standard operating procedures and so on. So quite serious allegations about patient care. And they also spoke about the vacancy rate being very high within certain staff groups, registered nursing staff group. There was an over 10% vacancy rate. And amongst the medical staff group, the vacancy rate was 13.76%. I mean, could you address those in turn and tell us what progress you've made in 22 months?
Yes, definitely. I'll go to Francis first, and then I'm sure Kevin and Andrew will want to come in. Francis.
Yes, thanks very much. So, as I suggested earlier, we had a return visit from the Healthcare Improvement Scotland in the end of January there. And I worked with them just to make sure that I wasn't saying anything. We haven't had the final report from them. We are working with them in terms of trying to give them additional information as well, and that's their methodology. But what they have suggested in terms of their initial feedback to us was that the inspection team didn't escalate any concerns around the care and safety provided to patients during
that time. Are there still five beds in four-bedded bays?
Yes. Or still are.
There are,
yes.
Right, okay.
Yes, yes.
And have you carried out all the risk assessments that were required?
Every single day, those patients in those the fifth bed and the four-bedded rooms are risk assessed every single day. And throughout the day, if those patients change, those are escalated through the staff safety huddle. And that's what we talked about earlier in terms of staff being comfortable to raise those concerns. If we are unable to mitigate the risks, we try to move patients out of those areas as quickly as we possibly can. But in order to deal with the demand, we're still relying on contingency beds to support the flow of patients through the Forth Valley Royal Hospital site, as are a number of hospitals across Scotland. But we've got those risk assessments. They're assessed every day. There's senior professional support to reassess them if there is any concerns raised by staff. And we've got a system of flow within the hospital to try and move patients out of those situations wherever possible. And the infrastructure to support the patients in those fifth beds and the four-bedded rooms have been significantly improved in terms of the equipment and the support that we provide. However, the care that was being provided during that inspection visit, there were no concerns raised at all. The same inspectors that were here just before I came into the board in October 2022, so the previous visit was September 2022, and they saw... It was the same inspectors who came and revisited us in January, and they saw a significant improvement in the safety of care. There were no concerns around patient safety during that visit. They also saw it within the emergency department and within the acute assessment unit, a very calm environment. It was a very busy environment on the 3 days that they were there. They said it was very calm, well-led. The staff commented that from a leadership point of view, there was great leadership visibility and that they were able to raise their concerns. They spoke to a number of patients throughout that visit, and the patients recognised it was a busy environment, but they had no concerns around their safety or the care that was being provided to them, and gave very favourable feedback in terms of the care that was being provided to them, even in the context of an incredibly busy emergency department and acute assessment unit.
OK, and where are we with things like staff vacancy rates?
The vacancy rates are certainly below where we would have been in that point in time. There's a number of things we've been doing. We've been doing sort of tracking ongoing and speeding up the process to get recruitment in place. So under 10% will be where we are in those main groups. We track and monitor against our other boards in nursing midwifery, allied health professionals and the medical side of things, all of which I'd be confident we'd be in... I don't want to use it in the pack, but we're in the mix of the same sort of averages as other boards are facing. Vacancies are a challenge. They are a challenge. We recognise that. But we've been doing some work recently to look at our funded establishment, tying in with our financial work to make sure that we understand where all our vacancies lie. And the other part of it is getting the process right. We've been doing some, as we call it, man marking, to make sure that all these vacancies that are in the system are being progressed very rapidly. So definitely having made improvements in that space, and that's a work ongoing as we speak.
Okay, as has been suggested by other members of the committee, it might be useful for you to follow up in writing with some of that more up-to-date information, just so that we've got that data on the record. I mean, I think my final reflection really is to follow on from the deputy convener's last salient question, which is three of you are very new to very senior positions in the health board. Did the people who left go through any kind of exit interview?
We've had exit conversations with everybody, yes. We've been, a degree they'll be different in every case, but yes, we've been, and we're looking at lessons learned from all of this. I guess that's what we're reflecting back in.
the work we've tried to do is consolidate, and you know, we don't want interim arrangements. The work we're doing now is to kind of consolidate that team and make sure we can do that in the best possible way. But obviously we've filled spaces where we needed to get that kind of that traction, and that's helped us to kind of move the agenda forward. So some of that reflection on those that have left us or have moved on, and changes we've made in the executive, are ongoing conversations.
Okay, but I think my question is there a kind of formal process whereby somebody who leaves the health board, who's been the chief executive for a number of years, or who's been in a senior HR role for a number of years, I suppose also down to those nursing staff who've left, who have now created vacancies in the system. Well, let me finish. So my question is, do you have systems in place to understand why nurses have left the health board's employ, why the chief executive left the employ? I know it's a retirement in that case, but other senior posts, people have left, you're the new team. Were interviews carried out to capture and record the reasons why people left?
There's two parts of an answer. One is, sure, we have an exit interview arrangement in place that everybody would have that opportunity to have that exit interview. We recognise, and we've had conversations with our colleagues in the trade unions, that we recognise improvements could be made in that space. Not all of them are happening, so we want to get more consistency in that space. I guess for the senior levels, we'd probably do things slightly differently. That's more a kind of one-to-one interaction, which would be more detailed and reflecting on what we can learn from that experience.
Janie, last word to you.
Yeah, no, absolutely. I'm aware that is offered to anyone who wishes to depart the health board. But I'm also informed that that's a confidential process. And so the lessons learned have to also be kept in a confidential space. But we could perhaps look at how we can transfer some of that and make sure that we're getting overarching thematic areas that are coming into understanding improvement as opposed to specific areas.
Yeah, I mean, don't misunderstand me. I'm not asking for you to send in copies to us as a matter of public record, people's reason for leaving. I'm just asking whether you, as a matter of good practice, are monitoring those reasons so that you can establish if there are trends or if there are other things. I mean, we've spoken about whistleblowing, for example. If there are cultural issues, which means you're not able to retain staff at any level, if you're able to monitor that. I'm very sorry, we're bang out of time, so I'm sorry I wasn't able to bring you back in. But please feel free, if there's something pertinent that you want to draw to the attention of the committee, perhaps if you capture that in a written submission after today's session, that would be something we would appreciate. So can I thank you, Amanda Croft, Janie Musk-Cusker, a happy post Forth Valley NHS board life. To Andrew Murray, Kevin Reith and Professor Francis Dodd, thank you also for all contributing to the evidence session this morning. It's been greatly appreciated. We'll suspend the meeting to allow for a change of witnesses. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. I'll now take the committee back into public session. And the second half of our agenda this morning is an examination of a briefing paper prepared by the Auditor General on decarbonising heat in homes. So can I welcome our witnesses from Audit Scotland this morning, Auditor General Stephen Boyle. You're very welcome. And the Auditor General this morning is joined by Cornelius Chikwama, who's an Audit Director at Audit Scotland. You're very welcome. And Derek Hoy, who's an Audit Manager at Audit Scotland. We've got quite a number of questions to put. Before we get to those questions, Auditor General, can I invite you to give us an opening statement?
Thank you, Convener. Good morning, Committee. I'm pleased to bring this morning my report on the Scottish Government's plans to decarbonise heating in homes. Around 15% of Scotland's overall greenhouse gas emissions come from 2.5 million occupied homes. Reducing emissions from heating our homes will make a significant contribution to meeting Scotland's 2045 net zero target. My report considers the actions in the Scottish Government's heat and building strategy that relate to housing. It looks at the scale of challenge facing the Scottish Government to reduce emissions from heating homes, what steps it's taken so far, and what's still to be done. The Scottish Government's approach focuses on two things. It intends to scale up its long-standing work to improve the energy efficiency of Scotland's homes. And by 2045, it is targeting the mass switch away from carbon-emitting systems like gas boilers to cleaner heating systems such as heat pumps. But the scale and pace of activity must increase significantly if the Scottish Government is to realise its ambitions. The Scottish Government is working to create the right conditions now to enable households to make the changes needed, but it faces significant risks. It's a complex process, no doubt, that relies upon several stakeholders, including the public, private sector investors, industry, and with the UK Government. Interrelated factors such as new legislation, public and private investment, supply chain growth, and infrastructure development are all key to its future success. The Scottish Government has laid some of the foundations to enable it to move forward with its plans, such as developing governance arrangements and increasing the capacity of its heat and buildings programme team. It now needs a clear plan of action to take forward the delivery of its heat and buildings strategy. The Scottish Government has estimated that the total cost of decarbonising heating in Scotland's buildings to be around £33 billion across the public and private sector and households. £1.8 billion of public money over the current parliamentary term has been committed. The Scottish Government must ensure it achieves value for money from its investment, and it must work effectively with the private sector to ensure funding and finance is available for homeowners and industry to support a large-scale change in how we heat our homes. Convener, as ever, Cornelius, Derek and I look forward to answering your questions. Thank you.
Thank you very much indeed. Can I pick up straight away one of the themes of that introduction, which is about the governance arrangements? And I think in the report you say that the Scottish Government should finalise governance arrangements for its heating building strategy as soon as possible, is the expression you use, i.e. there's a degree of urgency, I think, to this, and that seems to be quite instructive when we look at some of the dates in the report and the scale of the challenge to be met by those dates. I mean, can you tell us what governance arrangements need to be finalised at this stage by the Scottish Government?
Yeah, very happy to, Convener. I think I'll pass to Derek in a moment. Actually, I can just take the committee through, I guess, some of the history of the governance around net zero within the Scottish Government, and then some of the emerging plans within government. There is some recent history, Convener, if you allow me to reflect back on our report from the summer, where we in Audit Scotland reviewed the overall governance arrangements within the net zero ambitions within the Scottish Government, and noted, I think, and I'm paraphrasing slightly, but it was relatively slow within the Scottish Government net zero department to have clear structures with how it wished to deliver its ambitions. There has been progress since then, but I think I would agree with your assessment that there is a degree of urgency given the scale of change that is required. Having effective governance arrangements alongside a clear, tangible plan, which is one of the central recommendations we make in today's report. The strategy is there. We're aware, of course, that there is complexity and uncertainty with the current consultation on future bill that might change some of the targets and how the government will deliver its ambitions. But that needs to be rooted in a clear set of governance arrangements. Derek can say a bit more, convener, as to kind of where the government is going next.
Thanks, Auditor General. Yeah, so I think a lot of progress was made really since late 2022, when a new programme director came on board to the heat and buildings team at the Scottish Government. Having that role filled has let them really kind of make good progress in deciding what those governance arrangements would be. I wouldn't want to go into too much detail about what those arrangements actually are, because they were very much a work in progress when we spoke to the Scottish Government. It might be best to speak to the Scottish Government to get more details about how they are taking shape now. But I think, you know, things like an overarching kind of programme board, for example, and an independent strategic advisory group, those were the sorts of ideas that have been floated around, or not floated around, but being discussed or set up at the time. So I think it might be best to speak to the Scottish Government to get an update on where those are. But I think what we took assurance from was the pace of work since that programme director came into post. A lot of work had been done in that interim period, and I don't expect it will take much longer for them to finalise those arrangements.
OK, but there was a recurring theme, though, which has come out in the report. I mean, if I look at the third recommendation in your report, it talks about the need to identify the staff numbers and skills required. I mean, it sounds like a good old-fashioned workforce plan, which we speak about a lot at the Public Audit Committee. I mean, is that in place? Is that what arrangements are underway to make sure it is in place? If it's not yet, where are we on progress with that?
As Derek mentions, Convener, the government has made progress, certainly since we reported the more overarching report in the summer of last year in terms of staffing up its net zero department. And I think, as the committee heard in evidence from the Director General, that the workforce plan is now in place and there's a clear direction of travel within the Scottish Government about how it gets the right people in the right place to deliver its ambitions. There's also a recognition, and before we maybe go back to a couple of specifics on governance, there's a recognition within government, quite rightly, that this cannot be achieved by one directorate. And then more broadly, the Scottish Government can't deliver its net zero ambitions itself. There's a complex chain with which it has to encourage individuals, relationships with other parts of the public sector and absolutely the private sector to get this right. You mentioned one of our recommendations, Convener. I think it's intrinsically connected to the other recommendation that I've touched on briefly. The strategy is there, but it has to be underpinned by a clear delivery plan of what actions are going to be taken to support the implementation of the strategy. I think one other point we make in the report on governance on paragraph 33 of the report is that the government has now, since November, put in place what they're referring to as a monitoring and evaluation framework to support the implementation of aspects on public reporting on progress of the heat and building strategy. They'll need to keep that under very close review, accompanied by a clearer, more overarching delivery plan. So some steps of progress, workforce plan's part of that, convener, but there's key steps to take given the scale and complexity of this programme over the next 5, 10, 20 years to deliver its success.
But have you had an opportunity to evaluate the evaluation framework? I mean, do you have any sense of whether the monitoring and evaluation framework that was published back in November will be up to the job that's been set for it?
I think it's probably, given the short space of time between its publication and the publication of our own report, it's not something we've taken a view on its adequacy. I think what's fair to say is that we'll continue to be engaged clearly through our audit work, both of the audit of the Scottish Government itself and further public reporting that we'll do on progress towards net zero. That will be part of our assessment in due course, but we've not formed a view yet. Ultimately, of course, it's for the Director General, together with Scottish Government colleagues and non-executives, for them to be satisfied that this is the appropriate framework to assess their progress.
And because the other thing is a delivery plan, isn't it? And I think there's talk of the production of a delivery plan by the end of this year, this calendar year, by the end of 2024. I mean, do you consider that to be a reasonable timescale? Is it coming too late, actually, when you look at the targets and the timescales that have been set? What's your opinion on that?
So the end of 2024 is the date that we've put in the report. So I think weighing up the number of variables that exist here, the complexity, that there may be changes to some of the timescales following the conclusion of the consultation on the bill, I think there has to be a degree of space. I think we're talking about a number of months here to take stock and then translate those findings into a clear delivery plan. That, I don't think it detracts from the overall sense that there is some urgency to this. You'll see through other parts of the report that given the importance that the transition to clean heating systems will play in delivering net zero ambitions, that hasn't happened at the pace thus far. And that's included aspects of the establishment of the team and the governance arrangements. All of these have to be pointing in the right direction at the right pace, convener. But I think by the end of 2024 feels about the right time. But I think we'd start to get more concerned if it drifted beyond that.
OK. I mean, I don't know whether you've got a view or whether you're willing to state on the record your view of the dilution in some cases and abandonment in others of targets. I mean, the original target was that by 2030, 1 million homes out of the 2.5 million would be converted, that we would see a complete phase out of all new gas boilers by around about those target states, that we would have 22% of heat, and that's not households, but I suppose the measure of heat, 22% of that would be generated by renewables. All of those targets seem to have been dropped.
So you're right when you say, and I think we similarly reference these changes in the report, together with amendments to aspects of the targets that are indicated through the current consultation on the new bill. Our report also draws on subject experts who have also made assessments of the likely progress of the Scottish Government to deliver its interim and eventual net zero targets by 2045, most notably the Committee on Climate Change, who have expressed reservations about the pace of progress that the Scottish Government is forecasting to make. And it's clear, convener, that it will be incredibly challenging to deliver the interim targets by 2030. All the more reason, therefore, that by 2045, to deliver that target, which will similarly be stretching given the scale of change that is going to be required over the next 21 years, the effective arrangements are put in place now. So there's clearly work to do here.
OK. I mean, there are certainly, I think, indications in your report that you are calling into question some of these targets. And I think there is a credibility question, isn't there, about whether or not the scale of the change. I mean, I think you say there are 2.5 million households, and I think you reference 26,000 households that have seen heat pumps, for example, installed. So it's around about 1% of a completion rate, which by my rough arithmetic leaves over 98% of households that have not had these conversions.
So that's one of the most fundamental points of our report, that if you allow me just delve into history for a second, I think probably it's fair to say that in the 2010s, the government's focus was around improving the quality of insulation, the energy efficiency of Scotland's homes. And I think we fairly say in the report that they made pretty reasonable progress in that environment. To deliver net zero, though, decarbonising heating systems had to quite clearly become the next phase. Our judgment was that the government was slow in making the change in terms of its focus and resources into that environment. And that's probably borne out by some of the statistics you mentioned, convener, that the rate of installation of heat pumps pales into very small numbers compared to the overall target of 80% plus of gas boilers that exist. this is going to be a really complex programme. There's no doubt about that. You know, looking at Scotland's housing stock, they're not all going to lend themselves to installing heat pumps. There'll have to be really careful plans and transitions to review the range of heating systems that can make the difference towards low carbon. And I think it's also reasonable to draw, and I'm sure the committee will to explore further, is how that's done in a just way, just transition, not exacerbating fuel poverty that exists in Scotland. So all of these factors are captured in the government's heat and buildings strategy. But I think what we're talking about now is a step change and navigating through the complexities that exist currently to deliver all of that. And you know, myself, Cornelius and Derek can explore very happily with some of the pillars and how that approach has been taken forward.
Right, that's very useful, thank you. Can I turn to Colin Beattie now to put some questions to you about funding and investment? Colin.
Thank you. Good morning, General. I mean, nothing happened without money. And this whole programme hangs on whether public and private investment can be obtained in very, very large quantities. And one of the recommendations in the report is that the Scottish Government should clarify how it will use public money in the short and long term to support the delivery of its heat and building strategy objectives while achieving value for money. That's the fourth recommendation in the report. When would you expect the Scottish Government to be able to do this? And what evidence would you expect to see to demonstrate that value for money is being achieved?
So you're quite right, Mr. Beattie, that the Scottish Government cannot achieve this alone. Now, this is going to rely upon a very clear combination of private sector investment, individual household investment, accessing grants, loans, and a variety of factors to deliver it. But the introduction of private sector finance, together with creating a supply chain, is going to be a key component of this. Again, I'll turn to Derek in a moment just to maybe update the committee on the judgments of the Green Heat Task Force, which was one of the external reference bodies that the government created, acknowledging all of the complexity. I can explore that a bit further, but I may say a word myself about the relative investment of the Scottish Government compared to its estimate of what this is going to take in totality. So I mentioned in the introductory remarks, the Government's estimate is going to take over £30 billion, so £33 billion to deliver this change. And it's currently set aside £1.8 billion of investment over this parliamentary term to support through a variety of different measures. Some of it is about grants, some of it's to continue existing funding arrangements in terms of insulation, Mr. Beattie. That will change. I think that's inevitable. This isn't going to stop the end of this parliamentary term. And I think we've had no involvement in this one, but I was listening to today's report from the Institute of Public Policy and Research, who are again exploring the extent to which public investment in this is going to help it deliver the scale of change that's needed. These will be policy decisions, of course, over this term and into the future. Value for money will be an assessment that's required and one that we'll make in due course, but also that public officials and parliamentarians will want to make about whether £1.8 billion is enough, is it delivering effectively? And that will be set out through a combination of different ways. So we'll have a role to play in that. But it's clear that there's going to have to be continued investment, both on a public and private sector basis, for many, many years to come. Again, I'm going to pause if you're content, Mr. Beattie. I'm going to ask Derek to say a bit more about the engagement the government's had with private sector funders and where that might go next. Derek.
Thanks, Auditor General. Yes, so the Scottish Government set up the Green Heat Finance Task Force, which is a combination of individuals from across the from financial institutions, public sector and heating and buildings experts, etc., to try and tease out the options that might be available to provide finance to households and to businesses, etc., to make the necessary changes to how we heat our homes. So I think a lot of the findings from its initial report, there's a second report due out later this year, but from its initial report, much of the findings resonate with what we're saying in our report in terms of the huge scale of risk and challenge that there is in delivering this scheme. So the market is very much in its infancy at the moment. It's not to say that funding and finance isn't in place and that the mechanisms to deliver that aren't in place, but the market isn't quite mature enough yet for those things to take off. And that those are the sorts of the role of the Scottish Government is to try and create those conditions whereby the market can then grow and private investors will have more confidence to invest into those funding schemes. And that's the kind of real catalyst that would drive, hopefully, large-scale change and start moving towards the Scottish Government aims and objectives. But yeah, very very much in line in terms of the risks and challenges, very similar to what we found in our own report, Mr. Beattie.
To me, there's two ways that the private sector gets involved in this. One is by directly financing projects, discrete projects, and the other by providing finance to householders to carry out whatever works are needed in their home. Has consideration been given as to what the balance on that is going to be? It seems to me problematical that by providing the facility to go into debt to do this is going to be particularly attractive to households. And I just wonder if any analysis has been done on this, if any work's been done on this.
Not that I'm aware of, Mr. Beattie. That's certainly something we could go and look into, but it's not something we looked into as part of the audit.
Because if we're looking, for example, at just transition, to what extent is the private sector going to be involved in just transition as such? Because just transition implies helping those who are less well off make that transition without getting into financial difficulties or fuel poverty or whatever. And I'm struggling to see a role for the private sector there, because the private sector requires a return. So how does that work with public sector funding?
Maybe I'll offer a couple of aspects, and Cornelius might want to come in a moment again. There's a huge opportunity for business here. I think that this is that if I can give us the right statistic, Mr. Beattie, perhaps just to illustrate the change, if I can lay my hands on it. The number of accredited gas installers in Scotland dwarfs those who are currently able to install heat pumps or any other low-carbon heating system. So inevitably, to deliver this programme through regulation, through investment, through incentives, raising public awareness will all be parts of the strategy that government will want to play. But for the private sector, with the right conditions and market certainty, so that all the signals about timescales, that there's clear opportunity so businesses can feel confident to invest in a market, knowing what the timescales that they can plan, they can reskill their workforce, new entrants into the market. If we look at just based on the estimates that I've mentioned in terms of some of the numbers, there's over £30 billion at play here in Scotland. This ought to be a very attractive market, but the right conditions have to be. And that's the early feedback that businesses and their representatives have given. They're looking for that level of certainty so that they can make the shift at the right point away from gas installations into low carbon systems. You mentioned about, I'll come to just transition in a moment, but I think it's also worth acknowledging that this is part of the government's thinking. The consultation on the bill is already exploring how some of the incentives or arrangements could be put in place so that households make the transition and then the knock-on effect back to businesses. Reference to trigger points when people buy a new property or sell a property, that in itself opens up a window for when a low-carbon system has to be installed in their property. Inevitably, this will have to be accompanied by a range of loans and grants. Loans, as you mentioned, will be one of the mechanisms that the private sector can become involved in this new model of low-carbon systems. I'll maybe pause a moment because I think Cornelius might want to say a bit more about that. And again, of course, I want to return to your point about just transition as well, Mr. Beaton. Cornelius.
No, thank you very much, Auditor General. So I guess maybe there are maybe a number of issues to reflect on here. I think there's an issue of affordability, loans being available to households so that they can afford to make the investments. But when we look at value for money, I think for households, there's a question, when does it become worthwhile for households to decide, you know, they would want to make the switch? I think that is really going to be the biggest test for value for money. If government can get to a stage where households are deciding themselves that it is worthwhile to switch from gas boilers to alternative technologies, I think then we would have cracked the value for money challenge. I think a second element of value for money is recognizing that, you know, government can reduce emissions from houses, from people's homes, but it has other options to reduce emissions elsewhere. You know, it has to be looking at the totality of the challenge it has. And the key question there is, if it's going to spend a pound on reducing emissions from homes, could it have achieved more emissions reductions had it chosen to reduce emissions elsewhere? Now, that is a question that Scottish Government will have to grapple with. Where is it going to get the best returns in emissions reductions? I think you make an important point, Mr. Beattie, on the role of private sector and just transition. I think there's a recognition there that, yes, the private sector might not have a direct role to play, but I think policy has a role to play in shaping what the private sector does in relation to just transition. I think key things to highlight there is how we are going to regulate competition as these markets emerge, and what measures are going to be put around consumer protection. So these are things that may be important in thinking about just transition. And the question there is, you know, do the powers around these lie with the Scottish Government, or some of this is for the UK Government? And that then raises an important question on how the Scottish Government and the UK Government are working on these issues. Thank you.
Now, the Scottish Government at the moment, just focusing on just transition, already has some financial support schemes in place. Has the government actually estimated how quickly those current schemes will become oversubscribed? This is the schemes for individuals. Because clearly, you know, there's a limited amount of public funding.
You're right, Mr. Beattie. Cornelius might know a wee bit more about the forecasting, but just for the role of just transition, effectively looks to insulate, if you pardon the pun, households currently experiencing fuel poverty or at risk of experiencing it from, you know, being forced to adopt a low-carbon heating system and thereby exacerbating, you know, their exposure to fuel poverty. So currently, the government set aside a range of measures, one, you know, being funding to social housing providers, £200 million over the course of this parliamentary term. And it's a very live risk. You know, if you've just been looking at the, just draw the committee's attention to Exhibit 3 in our report, that the percentage of households in experiencing fuel poverty, 24% before in 2019, that's risen to 35%, all with the, you know, energy crisis, cost of living challenges. So these all have to be factored in to ensure that as we transition to low-carbon heating systems, which we must, but that doesn't, you know, draw new households into fuel poverty, or for those already experiencing it, for their circumstances to deteriorate. So the government has set aside funding to the extent to which that will be eaten up by demand. I think it's probably quite difficult to forecast. Cornelius might have the most up-to-date figures, Mr. Beattie, but again, this will be set on a rolling basis through each annual budget process. Cornelius?
Thank you. Yes, I think probably the key thing to highlight is, you know, fuel poverty remains quite high. The latest figure we have is 35% of households in Scotland are considered to be in fuel poverty. Now, if you consider what government is investing at the moment, it probably highlights that actually maybe more is likely to be demanded going forward. To what extent that is, we haven't been able to see any assessments done by the Scottish Government. But I think it's fair to say that more resources would be required around protecting households.
It's certainly a very startling figure, 35% in fuel poverty. And yes, the Scottish Government's obviously going to have to find more money to be able to make that transition for those individuals, and that's a huge task. How challenging is it going to be to actually achieve a just transition in decarbonising heat for homes? I mean, 35%, that's a huge amount.
So this is incredibly complicated. You know, as we mentioned, just some of the factors that will have to be overcome. So tackling fuel poverty, the government, to meet its own ambitions of by 2040, no more than 5% of people of Scotland will be fuel poor. And that used probably too loosely, Mr. Beattie, talk about step change, but this is a hugely significant challenge from where we are currently and approaching the middle of the 2020s. In 16 years' time, to move from 35% to 5%. So that will require, not just a just transition, but also a significant move from an existing circumstances. And that will be, and the strategy covers aspects of this, as we expect the delivery plan too. So continuing to support effective insulation of properties, easier said than done, because some of the more straightforward insulation will be done already. Much of Scotland's housing stock isn't easy to deliver effective insulation. The age of the properties, its condition, tenement buildings don't easily lend themselves to effective insulation. Some of these housing stock will be harder to retrofit to low carbon systems as well. So there is a very significant challenge to be met. And your assessment that more funding will be required, I think that's fair. I think that the sources of that funding, whether it comes from private sector or probably more likely increases in public sector funding, will have to be part of this plan.
OK, thank you. Graeme Simpson wants to come in on some of these points before I bring in Willie Coffey. So, Graeme.
Thanks very much. I've just been reflecting on everything that's been said so far. And what struck me is we've got very ambitious fuel poverty targets, as you've said already. And I just wonder whether there is a bit of a contradiction between having those targets which Parliament set and wanting to decarbonise, which right now, if one was to think of getting rid of your gas boiler, there's a very good chance that you could end up with a very expensive heating system to install, and B, something that costs far more to run. So is there a risk, actually, of people being plunged into fuel poverty if they were to make the move now?
I think if it were left to the market, Mr. Simpson, that would be a very clear risk. That, and even just reading before today's session, so, for example, the price per unit of gas is currently lower than that of electricity. Therefore, if we move to the decarbonising process is one moving away from fossil fuel based to renewable based but electric powered systems. So these are very clear factors that will have to be weighed up to deliver both those. Whether they may or may not be competing demands, but they're both very challenging. So to deliver the statutory target of no more than 5% of people experiencing fuel poverty, and to deliver the 2045 net zero targets to decarbonise Scotland's heating systems, both are going to require clear plans, navigating all through the complexities that we touch on in the report, but they are undoubtedly stretching.
We'll end up in fuel poverty. I mean, I'm simplifying it, but you'll end up there because the cost of heating your home is too much for you, in essence. So if you rightly say that if you go on to a fully electric system, at the moment that costs far more than gas. I mean, that's correct, isn't it? So that balance has to change.
And these will be one of the safeguards that, you know, will be the hallmark of the government's plans to ensure a just transition. So just transition, moving towards fuel poverty targets, are under the same banner. Cornelius might want to say a bit more about, you know, the government's thinking in this area, Mr. Simpson, but the complexity of this is hugely significant. Government recognises this, I think, you know, and will be very important to see what comes out, therefore, of the consultation and then future legislation, governance, monitoring arrangements and so forth, that both these aspects of decarbonising Scotland's heating systems are treated with, you know, the equal priority over the course of the years to come. Cornelius.
Thank you. Yeah. No, I think the Auditor General is right. I mean, the risk of, you know, I don't want to say plunging, but increasing fuel poverty is there in this transition. But maybe if we look at, you know, the two pillars to decarbonising, you know, improving energy efficiency and then changing the technology, one would expect that if we are able to make progress on improving energy efficiency, that actually reduces the amount of energy that households need. So that could mitigate some of the impact on fuel poverty. Now, as the Auditor General said earlier, you know, the Scottish Government has made progress on improving energy efficiency, but I think there's still more to be done around that. On the second pillar, I think that's where the challenge is, you know, that switching from gas to alternative technologies. At the moment, the alternative technologies are much more expensive than the gas options. So I think that is where the risk is greater. So it's how do you balance that energy efficiency side with what options you have around switching from gas to alternative sources.
And have you done any analysis of the difference in costs, you know, what it would cost the sort of average household to switch from gas to something else? And I know there are various alternatives. How much it would cost to maintain these systems?
It wasn't part of the scope of this report to do that that type of analysis for what it means for individual households. Derek may want to say a bit more about some of the insight that we have, but I think we'll probably have a greater feel for that, Mr. Simpson, following the conclusion of the consultation on the next bill about where the government intends to go. At a high level, you know, the price varies depending on the property, the type of system that's chosen, any groundwork that's necessary around the property. Yeah. But, you know, you're looking in, I think the last estimates, this is a fairly broad scale, so forgive me for that, but between £7,000 and £15,000. Is the anticipated cost of installing a heat pump. There are other options, you know, I think, and for some properties, a heat pump won't be possible, and you'll be looking at modern electric storage systems. There's then the option around heat network, district heating systems, that are the other various models. So it's probably not easy to say with any degree of confidence about what an average might be and how that relates to individual properties. Nonetheless, you can say that at a relatively high level for almost every household, this will be a significant investment that people will want to plan for, want to know what finance is available, what grants are at their disposal to. But again, I'll turn to Derek if he wishes to add.
Thanks, Auditor General. Probably not too much more to add, to be honest. I think, Mr. Simpson, come back to your point about have we looked at an average cost? No. I think the main reason for that is I'm not sure how much validity there'll be to calculating an average, because there'll be so much variation in that cost based on a whole range of factors, type of property, age, building fabric, etc. So we didn't really see much value in trying to carry out that exercise. But yeah, I think as the Auditor General points out, for any household, it's going to be a significant investment. And, you know, I suppose the other thing to mention is looking at that over the long term as well. It's a significant investment just now. The cost of a clean heating system at the moment is, on average, more expensive than, say, replacing a gas boiler like for like. But those costs could come down over time as technology develops, as economies of scale are achieved, and industry you would expect those costs to come down over time. So I suppose bearing in mind we're looking at a 21-year timescale from now, it's not, although that's the situation at the moment, and it could be more expensive, that could change over the course of the next few years. So it's, but there's a lot of different factors involved and a lot of unknowns.
I'll just make a final observation, Convener, that if we're just talking about housing, I think we can deal with new housing relatively easily, and the government is looking at improving the standards of new housing. I was at an event last night looking at, just talking about passive housing. There's serious consideration being given to, you know, introducing new building standards so that new homes would meet those very high standards of energy efficiency, which I think could deal with the fuel poverty issue almost overnight. I think it would be very positive. But the challenge is the existing housing. So probably that's where the money has to go. Would you, is that something you'd agree with?
I recognise the scale of the challenge, and this is going to require effective engagement across many different stakeholders. So we've mentioned individuals, private finance into the system, engagement with the UK government in terms of the capacity of the energy grid, but perhaps also maybe just to... You mentioned passive house, Mr. Simpson, actually about clear and effective engagement with social housing providers and their representatives in Scotland, given the density of people living in fuel poverty will be living in social housing. So that there is a clear expectation around what's expected of them, what funding is available to support both the increasing confidence around insulation and then what transition arrangements are in place for low-carbon systems too.
OK, thank you. I'm going to bring in Willie Coffey next. Willie.
Thanks very much, Convener. Auditor-General, the public perception of all of this isn't great, I don't think. There's still a lot of work needs to be done. We've said that before, and I think we're saying it even now. When constituents talk to me about this transition, they ask a number of questions. What are the solutions on offer? I don't know where to find them or to talk, who to talk to about them. They ask if they'll be helped to install, you know, subsidy help to install whatever the devices are. But the main question they ask is, how much is this thing going to cost me to run? And just to get your view, what do you think is the one key sea change element that will begin the accelerated transition to take place? I think I know what it is. It's the cost of electricity. It's 4 times higher than gas. So even if we've got an army of heat pump engineers appearing from somewhere, even if we've got great subsidy schemes on offer, people will vote with their wallets and say, no thanks, it's too expensive. Because if you switch from your gas consumption just now to electricity consumption to heat your house, your bill, your electricity charge ratio is 4 times higher than it is at the minute. Do you think, do you accept that that is the key challenge that we face to effect the transition that we need at pace?
So I think that is one of the key challenges to overcome, Mr. Coffey. There's no question about this will require the public to engage and have confidence in transitioning from a fossil fuel-based system to a low-carbon system, that people will make both environmental but fundamentally economic decisions for them and their families. And if that is going to be at the expense of, you know, fuel poverty or other aspects of how they lead their lives, some will do it voluntarily. You know, I think as we've seen in the report that, you know, there have been some early adopters of heat systems going back, you know, nearly 10 years, but these are still very low numbers that we are talking about, you know, of 5,000 or so compared to, you know, targeting over 1.8 million households with gas boilers. So there's an enormous scale of change to take place. Derek might want to say a bit more, Mr. Coffey, but I would absolutely want to record the government recognise that this is one of the key challenges. So the badging it under a a public awareness strategy. And, you know, we set some of the detail out that paragraph 72 of the report. The public might well be very well aware of, you know, what's on offer, what grants are, but I accept your premise that people will make economic decisions and they'll want to be satisfied into the longer term what they are signing up for and what that cost might be. And this will be one of the challenges that the government will have to overcome together with its partners and the relationship that it has with the UK government in terms of the grid capacity and what some of the underlying cost drivers are for the disparity in price. I'll just turn to Derek if there's any wishes to add.
Yeah, I think just on the public engagement element, Mr. Coffey, I think there's, from the evidence we've gathered, there's a real acceptance at the Scottish Government that is a really important part of this. So it's putting an awful lot of effort into getting that right. That's all at a very early stage, so it's hard to say how effective that will be. And it's good that they've got a strategy in place. They've also got indicators in place to monitor how effective that will be. And also they're planning to come back and evaluate the public engagement strategy, I think, in 2026. But aside from that alone, there's a lot of other work going on as well. In Appendix 1 of the report, you'll see the list of various consultations that have gone on around this area, around the matter of heat decarbonisation and energy efficiency improvements. So I think it's something that the Scottish Government are very aware of. They're certainly not under any illusions of the scale of the task to sway public opinion on side. But I think, going back to the original point, things like cost are, you know, that is going to be a major factor in it. But there's a role for the Scottish Government to try and provide clarity on that, how much these systems will cost, what's the best system for your particular house, for example. So there's a lot of work that the Scottish Government can do to provide people with a bit more assurance and confidence. But yeah, there are factors out with their control, the Scottish Government's control as well, for example, the cost of electricity that will undoubtedly play a part.
I mean, that's the fundamental bottom line question for me. Consumers, the Scottish Government even, we don't control the price of electricity or the price of gas. We don't control it. So we're relying on cooperation from our partner government to look at this. Electricity prices in the UK are amongst the highest in the world. That's the bottom line. And if you say to people, make this transition, it will help the net zero, progress towards net zero, people will say, how much? How much is it going to cost me? So that there needs to be, in my view, convener, some work that reduces the cost of electricity. People I talk to say, why, when we're producing over 100% of our electricity needs in Scotland from renewable sources, is it costing me a fortune to use it? Why is it? So energy companies are still generating and creating the profits from this, but the public aren't getting the benefit. For me, convener, that's the key to getting this transition rolling faster, to do something on the price. And all the rest of the factors are important, Auditor General, but they will only chip away at this 1.8 million houses with gas central heating boilers, and they're just now, if people think that the cost to replace that and to use it and to pay for it is going to be excessively high.
So maybe just briefly on that with Mr. Coffey, I think we recognise in the report that engagement between the Scottish and UK governments is one of the fundamental pillars of delivering the successful transition, recognising the distinction between devolved and reserved powers between the two governments. The other aspect that's the case that in the government strategy is this about regulatory intent that they have, what their plans are around different dates that will, you know, fundamentally force consumers to make the change, as you would expect that you know, is far more likely to succeed in terms of people's willingness to comply if they recognise both the environmental benefits of it but don't feel that hitting them in terms of what it's going to cost them compared to where they were. So there's no doubt there is work, there is engagement, and there's regulatory clarity that will help that transition.
Okay. Thanks very much for that.
Thank you very much. I mean, one of the factors which is at play here as well is, and I think this is part of the consultation which is ongoing around the proposed legislation, which I understand I think will come before Parliament before the end of the year, is also within the housing market. So if you buy a property, there's an expectation that there'll be a condition put on that purchase that within a certain time frame you will convert, which again could have some interesting consequences, couldn't it?
Yeah, like you, convener, had I was aware of that aspect of the consultation. I think you would expect, I'm sure, as parliamentarians, you'll have the opportunity to scrutinise that and to explore how that might be implemented, as well as intended and unintended consequences of it. But there's no doubt that regulation will play a key part in terms of driving the level of change that's required, especially, I think, as Mr. Coffey's touched on, that so many other variables that exist along with both the price of electricity together with supply chain availability of private finance. So, yes, we await with interest the next stage of the legislation around this.
Thanks. Deputy Convener, Jamie Green.
Jamie. Thank you. There's a lot of very good ground has already been covered, but I've been listening with intent and wanted to mop up a few other areas where you might share your wisdom. One is on the first of all, I think, is more just an overarching discussion around how we define fuel poverty at the moment in the modern world. The technical definition is that a household would need to spend more than 10% or more of their net household income on fuel stroke energy consumption. And if that reaches 20% of the net income, it becomes extreme fuel poverty, as we know. But it doesn't take very much to fall into that category. And even someone on a fairly substantial income, perhaps a higher tax bracket paying household, would quite quickly find themselves in a position where their annual fuel bill might be £2,500-£3,000, which very easily in their net income takes them into that bracket. So there may be the worry that there's a sort of assumption that people on very low incomes or people on various benefits are the sole victims of the current sort of fuel energy issue?
Cornelius may want to say a bit more about some of the definitions, Deputy Convener, but I think probably maybe just again referring back to Exhibit 3 in the report, we're just looking at the step change of the increasing number of households in Scotland who have been classed as experiencing fuel poverty, and agreeing with your assessment also that that goes further into extreme fuel poor that some people will experience too, in the circumstances that we've seen over the past few years with energy price shocks as well. How that's distributed across different socioeconomic factors across the country, I think it is relevant, no doubt, that if depending on the choices that individual households make, what their housing costs might be too.
Yeah.
I think it's, again, you'd expect that that will be a key part of the government's thinking. To step back for a second, I mean, just to ensure that they deliver both these challenging targets, the statutory targets of both net zero by 2045, and then the significant reduction to only 5% of people in Scotland who are fuel poor by 2040. That's going to require real focused plans, all the various pillars around regulation and awareness too. Cornelius might want to say a bit more.
Thank you. Yeah, so I think in terms of the definition, it's not something we examined a lot in the report. Partly because there are statistical standards that I'm sure Scottish Government follows around this. But as Stephen says, I think if you were to look at the distribution of the people who are counted as in fuel poverty, that is likely to distribute across different socioeconomic groups. But I think it's fair to say that probably a lot of them are going to be within the low income categories. I think that's all I would say at this stage. The actual definition itself, there's a lot of standards I think that guides how Scottish Government applies that.
Is it therefore the case that one of the issues is that a lot of the schemes that exist, and I was looking at your appendix to your own report, Audit General Appendix 2 on the delivery schemes, it seems to be quite a complicated, stroke complex environment of subsidy. So there are a number of schemes. We have Warm Homes Scotland, delivered by Warmworks. We have area-based schemes delivered by local councils, Home Energy Scotland grants delivered by the Energy Savings Trust, and so on. And the number of households that are actually getting proper conversion of heating systems out of it is in the tens of thousands as opposed to the hundreds thousands or millions. But it does seem quite a complex landscape, and that's been referred to by other members. Is that something that could be simplified, do you think, or you know, because the risk is that if you leave things, as you said, to the market alone, and people's only exposure to accessing you know, improvements is via the private sector advertising these schemes in their own way, but equally with a view to making profit in their own way, then it becomes quite a dangerous environment for the consumer.
Yeah, I'd agree with you, Deputy Commissioner. I think there will always be a fundamental role for government alongside the market, especially if the government's statutory targets that the Parliament signed up to are to be delivered. The trick to pull off here, and I think it's that, as I mentioned earlier, the government's focus has in the 2010s was around improving the energy efficiency of properties, and I think as reasonably say in the report, they did that well. You know, so properties have become better insulated. But to ensure that just transition, it's again they're going to have to not move the focus solely again onto decarbonising heating systems, but do both. You know, continue to support effective energy insulation, and building on Mr. Simpson's earlier example of passive house, you know, effective retrofit and so forth, but that's done on a shared objective. In terms of the specifics around the different schemes, if I can maybe step back on an overarching basis, that has to be simple and easy for people to access. You know, so accessing the right schemes and knowing where they can get grants, what loans are available, all falls under fundamentally as a kind of one of the pillars of the government's plans is around public awareness and giving confidence both to individuals and the market. So there are many moving parts to this at the moment, but all the more reason I think where we got to an overall conclusion in the report, really, regardless of the strategy, got to have a clear delivery plan that underpins it.
Mm-hmm. Well, that's interesting. I mean, you talked about the sort of incarnations, and we hark back to the days of when solar panels on roofs was the big thing, and that then it developed into we'll come and insulate your home, and there's some grants available for that, and you can top it up yourself. And we're now talking about whole, you know, root and branch, taking out your current heating system and replacing it with new technologies, and most people probably don't understand what those technologies are. Does that open up any risk of increased exposure to rogue companies, to scams, to fake grant scenarios, to misleading advice being given to consumers and so on? Is that something that Ofgem particularly should be paying attention to?
Regrettably, I think there is a risk that consumers, especially with such a fundamental change in market conditions here, and we are talking about a need for a development of a new supply chain,
yeah,
new providers, some are providing finance, some providing insulation service, and I think, you know, history is littered with examples where there's, you know, such changes in market conditions that, you know, rogue operators will look to take advantage of ambiguity. So I think, you know, it's not the government hasn't recognised that. We think there is an engagement strategy, an awareness strategy, but there have to be effective safeguards in place about, you know, scams, as we've seen in the past. Yep. So Ofgem will have a role, and I think Consumer Scotland too, you know, the new public agency, well, I'm sure we'll want to give some consideration to what its role might be in that environment too.
Mm-hmm. That's assuming we have the people to do the work. As you said, there's a huge amount of people out there who can install new gas boilers, but that marked shift to installing new technologies and maintaining those ongoing, there has been a fair amount of pushback from industry in terms of their what's on offer, the incentives to do that, and retraining and reskilling staff. If there's not really a market that exists, there's a bit of chicken and egg involved, of course. But how, you know, do you think that the government is acutely aware of that? Do you think the plans that they've produced to ensure that we've got the people to do that transition are robust?
I'll pass to Cornelius to say a bit more about the government's plans around creating a supply chain, a workforce. Before doing that, I think I was struggling to get the statistic that, kind of, to illustrate the scale of change. I've now put my hands on it. So it's a note at paragraph 76 that Scotland currently has 200 accredited air source heat pump installers, relative to 8,700 gas installers. You expect that's going to have to flip.
Yeah.
To so effective engagement by government, enterprise and skills agencies, further education colleges, universities, so that this becomes an integral skill. Before Cornelius wants to come in, I think we can often phrase this as that this is a risk to success and this is a challenge to overcome. But there's an enormous opportunity if the conditions are right and government is able to provide confidence to the market and to consumers that there is, as I've mentioned, £30 billion potentially at play here in terms of economic growth and financial opportunities. But again, Cornelius can say more about the government's plans in this area.
Yes, I think this is an area where, government has been doing quite a lot of work through its supply chain development programs. I mean, in relation to skills specifically, we have things like the new mobile center for heat pump training, which is trying to provide training opportunities in a flexible way. We've got the climate change emergency skills action plan, which again is trying to make investments in skills. But the real test really is the numbers. And as the Auditor General says, we only have 200 certified installers. So this would suggest that whatever investments are being done in skills development in this area will need to scale up and potentially scale up very, very quickly. When we did the audit work, I think we did identify a number of challenges which are in our report. I think one of them is around the funding schemes available for retraining and upskilling, and the key issue there being around them being complex and challenging to access funds. That's what people are trying to access them have said. Some companies also still a bit reluctant to make those investments. The market is still growing. There's a lot of uncertainty as to what pace the market will take off. So again, these are things that will impact on the choices that are being made around skills investment. When you start looking at the larger companies that are looking at the wider UK market, I think they will then be looking at, well, what pace of growth are we likely to see in the UK vis-a-vis Scotland, and I think they'll be making their investment decisions, taking that into account, given the UK, well, the rest of the UK is on a much slower timeline. So I think those are the key issues, really, that I would say are coming out of the audit work that we have done.
Thank you. I appreciate we're out of time, Convener, so I'll park with other questions.
Thank you very much indeed, Jamie. And can I thank Auditor General you for your evidence this morning and also Derek and Cornelius for the input that you've given us. We will now need to consider what our next steps are and who perhaps we need to invite in to give us more evidence on this really important subject of both public policy and, I think, consumer interest as well. So with that, I'm going to draw the public part of this morning's proceedings to a close. Thank you.